Coming up next on Arizona Horizon, we'll talk about voter anxiety on this election day and why people vote the way they do. Also tonight, a presidential historian says that this is the most divisive election since 1860. And we'll look at past voting problems and the possibility of them happening again. Those stories next on Arizona Horizon.
Arizona Horizon is made possible by contributions from the Friends of Arizona PBS, members of your PBS station. Thank you.
Good evening and welcome to Arizona Horizon. I'm Ted Simons. Voters are heading to the polls today with long lines being reported at some locations in the Phoenix area. Polls will remain open tonight until 7 o'clock. Now, earlier today, Jeff DeWitt, who was part of the Donald Trump campaign, state treasurer, told voters that polls close at 9 p.m. The Secretary of State's office expressed, quote, deep concern over the misinformation and reiterated that polls are open until 7 p.m. What are the psychological factors behind why people vote and why they vote the way they do? How best to handle the anxiety that some feel over the voting process and the election in general? Joining us now is local psychologist Dr. Lisa Strohman. Thanks for joining us again and coming in on this election day. A lot of this, we'll get to the anxiety in a second. I'm already falling away. The psychological factors behind voting. Why do we do what we do?
Well, there's some big concepts, right? So what you're affiliated with, the party, oftentimes you get that from your parents early on. That doesn't tend to transfer over much. Religion is another big one. And then just kind of general, like your SES, like where you are in life, how healthy you are, how healthy the economy is. Some of those big concepts are some of the big ones.
Compare emotion versus reason, because we all figure we've done all of our studying, we're going to go in there and we're going to make the rational choice. Do we?
Most of the time we do, but we tend to go around with what other people are telling us to do. And that's the big change, I think, in this election before anything, is that the amount of information that we're getting via social media, from the news, it's 24/7, and they're getting to us in other ways. And what our friends are doing and what we see them post is starting to influence us.
When I was reading about this, I saw some psychologists and voting experts saying that all decision-making is unconscious. Is that true?
No, I wouldn't say that it's unconscious, but what they're probably relying on is some of the biases that exist. So we have cognitive bias, and so some of those things are what we have structured in our brains, like deep down, and that goes back to some of the stuff I talked about, like religious affiliation and party affiliation. So that's probably what they're referring to.
So the cognitive bias, though, can it make you do something that later you go, what the heck was I thinking?
Yeah,
it can.
It definitely can. Because oftentimes, it's like if you buy a car would be the best example, and you're looking at two different brands and you choose one brand over the other, you always start to think that the other brand is really, really bad and your brand is really, really good. And that's kind of that cognitive bias. Like, we have to affiliate more to the one that we've already agreed to. And so you entrench in that decision.
Even though later on you start seeing that other car on the road and you
may
go, that really
so
wasn't so bad after all, was
right.
it? Negativity bias. Now, we know that exists.
Right. And that's one of the things in this campaign, particularly, and all campaigns have had it. But again, I think it goes back to how often and how much negative information is getting thrown out there. And this campaign has been pretty severe in terms of, like, the extent and the severity of it.
Have we hit a tipping point, do you think, for negativity in political campaign? Every time we do go through one of these things, we think it can't get worse, and it does get worse. When does it stop getting worse?
I think a lot of people are getting turned off by it, and particularly the millennials. I think that this voting group that's starting to kind of come of age and starting to vote and pay attention really isn't going to put up with the stuff that the voters that have been voting for history, like, have done. And so that is actually turning against the candidates, in my opinion.
But psychologically, why is dislike a more compelling reason to vote?
I think that has to do with our affiliation with others, and we really have to feel like we're a member of a group. And if we dislike something, we want to make sure other people are with us. And so if somebody's doing something that we really don't like and we believe strongly against it, then it will push us further, kind of that bias again. It's going to push us further to do what we need to do to make sure that what we dislike doesn't get to be where it's trying to get.
Is that the reason why so many letters to the editors or letters to TV programs are often negative in general and hardly, rarely, if ever, positive?
Well, I think, I absolutely think so. I think that people need to feel that they have a voice. And I think that if you look at the research, people take in about six newspapers newspapers worth of data per day and generate 2 newspapers worth of data. So they're trying to get their voice heard in a massive amount of data that's out there.
Okay, we've got the massive amount of data out there. We've got choices to make. Sometimes we're doing things we don't even know what we're doing. We're anxious. We're nervous.
Mm-hmm.
You're a psychologist. I'm coming to you. I'm saying, I'm a voter. I'm anxious over this election. What do you say?
Number one, I ask them, what are they watching? What are they taking in? You know, turn some of that off, right? Kind of get yourself grounded again and not have so much influence from the outside media. Because I think that these talking points and how we're putting it up, we're using fear, we're using angst, and we're turning it against people. And it's just creating worse situations for people. So I always say, turn that down. You know, kind of center yourself.
And after you've turned it down and centered yourself, then what? Look on the bright side of life? I mean, what do you do?
Right, like figure out what was making you anxious. So when I'm with somebody, like I'll take them through and say, like, when did it start? Like, what are the things that are making you most anxious? And let's talk through that and why that, if it's there's reality or if it's really more hype and more just kind of the talking heads giving you those points.
But for some folks, I would imagine the talking heads, the negativity, the yelling, the screaming, the marching, the shouting, they're addicted to it, aren't they?
I think that drama is leading our nation more than ever. I would say that, yeah.
So what if I come to you again and I'm saying, you're telling me to stop watching all this stuff, but I feel like I'm missing something if I'm not there. I'm nervous about missing something too.
Right, that's where I think that people are turning to getting like Twitter updates and social media and things like that, which again, it ramps up their anxiety again because they have that fear of missing out, which is kind of across generations nowadays.
Are you seeing, I was gonna ask, are millennials different than folks of middle age, than seniors along these lines as far as anxiety, voter anxiety?
Different kinds of anxiety, certainly, yeah. I mean, I see teenagers all the way up. Teenagers actually are really interesting, even though they can't vote, but they're actually kind of filtering through kind of their parents' angst. And then, you know, the older, the boomer generation and those folks that I see, some of them are just really disheartened and quite frankly disgusted with like where the political system has gone.
Yeah.
And so they're trying to do their best to kind of hold on, but I think that there's a lot that's turning against it.
Before you go, I've heard that weather can impact how people vote. You agree with that?
I think that if they're disenfranchised because they don't want to send in inclement weather, then we're in big trouble.
Okay. So the idea that, you know, incumbents can be blamed. It's bad weather. It's like, oh, it's the same old, and I'm voting the incumbents out. That's a little far-fetched.
I think that's far-fetched.
What about fear?
Fear is definitely something that is driving elections, and it has driven elections for years. I mean, that's the platforms that we come across. Fear motivates people, and so that's why you see a lot more negativity on the news and things like that. It sells tickets, basically,
yeah.
And so that's why they use it.
And I read that those feeling ill, check this out, those feeling ill tend toward more physically attractive candidates. Does that make sense to you?
Interesting. I don't know where that study or that information would have come from. I mean, I think that people who are psychologically depressed or anxious or things like that, you know, I don't know, like physical illness, but you want to have somebody that's healthy, strong, somebody that, you know, you're trying to kind of get that affiliation with that. So that could be in that sense.
And that's yet another anxious metric point there if you're not feeling all that well.
Right.
Well, all right. Good information. Good to have you here on Election Day. Thanks for joining us.
Thank you.
A local presidential historian says that this is the most divisive election since 1860, which was just prior to the Civil War. Here to talk about why this race for the White House has been nastier than just about any other is Brooks Simpson, Foundation Professor of History at ASU. Good to see you again. Thanks for joining us.
Glad to be here.
Most divisive presidential election since 1860?
Well, after all, the 1860 election ended up with a war which cost hundreds of thousands of lives. So we're not quite there yet. But since then, yes, this has been a vicious election.
So let's talk about why this has been a vicious election and compare to what we saw or read about back in 1860.
I think that one thing that has now occurred is the kind of viciousness in American society, and it's a viciousness that I think has been fed by social media and the internet, that people can now anonymously say things about each other, that candidates are now using that 24/7 news cycle and using social media to go after each other in very vicious and very personal ways. And certainly Donald Trump has contributed a great deal of that just by himself.
We just had a psychologist on blaming social media for the fact that people are anxious, they're nervous, they're worried, they're upset. Why do we continue to allow all of these negative ads and this negative campaigning to work?
It's because that still draws us, that we can usually talk more about why we don't like somebody than why we like them. And we can reject people much more easily than we can accept them. So you can always point out the weak points of someone that you like, but when it comes to the negatives, you can just say, this person is unacceptable. It's easier to unite people by talking about what they're against than what they're for.
Now, again, the 1860 election, that was Lincoln's election, led to the Civil War. Talk more about that one and what the country went through there, and any similarities at all to what we're going through now.
In terms of the result, of course, was traumatic for the entire nation. But the election itself, in terms of how the candidates treated each other, not nearly so vicious. That the Democratic Party broke apart in 1860. Northern Democrats ran Illinois Senator Stephen A. Douglas. Southern Democrats ran the incumbent Vice President John Breckinridge. A new party sprung up, the Constitutional Union Party, with a fellow named John Bell, and his vice presidential candidate, Edward Everett, is best known as the guy who spoke for 2 hours before Lincoln spoke for 5 minutes at Gettysburg. And then Lincoln himself, who was seen to be a dark horse candidate to some, but who had been a master at building and keeping together a Republican coalition that eventually won.
Did the record show that it was divisive as the campaign went on and as Election Day approached, or was it divisive only because of what happened afterward?
More the latter, that the election itself was not nearly as vicious. We've had vicious elections before, and we've had a lot of character assassination before that would resemble this election much more in terms of the intensity of the campaign.
Which ones?
Oh, for example, I think in 1828, John Quincy Adams versus Andrew Jackson. Jackson's wife had not completed her divorce at the time that she married Jackson, so she was accused of bigamy. She, in fact, died soon after the election. John Quincy Adams was accused of pimping for the Tsar of Russia. So we're talking about people trading personal insults right and left.
So we've got this election, and we've got the personal insults and some just crazy talk coming
right
in different directions. Do you think we're going to see more of this? Have people had enough, or is this the beginning of the beginning?
I think we have to understand the unique impact that Donald Trump has had on American politics in this election cycle. That if you take Trump out, I don't think other candidates would have been quite so vicious as Donald Trump has been. The real question now is whether everyone learns in this election that, in fact, this personal viciousness, while it may, in fact, increase the negatives of your opposition and may make, you know, in this case, people question Hillary Clinton more, Trump's negativity has really done him no favors.
So, will a final result ease any of the acrimony, or are we going to veer, not toward a civil war, but is it going to be kind of a thing where the aftermath is worse than the campaign?
I think it won't be nearly as bad as I think people fear. That after a while, people's attention are going to, they're going to look at other things. I mean, we saw even past couple of weeks, people were watching this election, and then all of a sudden the World Series came along and people began paying attention to Cleveland versus the Chicago Cubs. People have a short attention span. That's also part of this social media culture. They go on to other things. And I don't think Trump can continue to sustain what he's commenced. Because I think a lot of people today just can't wait for this to be over.
No kidding. How do we get so divided?
I think in part because the Democrats ran a candidate who's had a long public record and built up her share of enemies, and there's a bit of Clinton fatigue going on at the same time. And at the same time, I don't think Republicans ever took the Trump candidacy seriously until it was too late.
Yeah, and they had everyone and their brother was running in the campaign.
That's
as far
right.
As the primaries were concerned, which opened the door for him, did it not?
Yeah, and not only that, but Trump was so confrontational. I think people were astonished with how blunt he was, and they weren't really prepared to respond.
Last question before you go. I've heard some people say that we are in a cold civil war right now. What do you think?
I think we are a country of extremes, that we're very polarized at this point. I think we're also exhausted. I think the challenge of the incoming president is going to be trying to bring people back together and try to move them forward. And it's not clear that's going to happen, given what we've already heard about what a Republican-controlled Congress might do against a Democratic president.
Would you be surprised if a third party emerged out of all this?
I would not be surprised if third parties emerged out of this. But the issue is, can you get enough people around to have just one third party? And I'm not clear if that's going to be the case.
All right. Very interesting information. We will see how this all plays out. Good to have you here. Thanks for joining us. We appreciate it.
Thank you.
Sixteen years ago, the presidential election wound up hanging, literally, by a bunch of dangling ballot chads in Florida. It was the most recent example of U.S. presidential elections experiencing voter irregularities. Here to talk about presidential election curiosities, past, present, and possibly future, is constitutional expert Robert McWhirter. Good to see you. Thanks for joining
us.
History of voting problems for president. I mean, obviously, the hanging chads, there's been a lot of stuff out there.
Well, first of all, let's start. There's been four different elections in the history of the country where the winner of the Electoral College did not win the popular vote. Now, the first was 1824. We've spoken about that in a prior one, where John Quincy Adams ended up besting Andrew Jackson and took the election by this, what was called the corrupt bargain, where he cut a deal with Henry Clay, who then became Secretary of State. And so that was the first one. Okay.
Right.
What happened there was 4 years later, Andrew Jackson knocked him off and he became president 4 years later. Okay. Next one's 1876. Rutherford B. Hayes was running against Samuel Tilden, and there were these floating 20 electoral votes. Samuel Tilden was winning in the Electoral College, and he won the popular vote. Well, there was these 20 floating votes that nobody kind of grabbed, and everything was just sitting around until they made the bargain, or the compromise of 1877 is what it was called, and those 20 votes went over to Rutherford B. Hayes, who became president. Now, what happened with that was the bargain was Rutherford B. Hayes agreed to remove federal troops from the South, ending Reconstruction and putting the country into the Jim Crow South.
Interesting.
What's interesting about that is Rutherford B. Hayes was a Republican, and his betrayal of Abraham Lincoln, Republican, mm-hmm. and Grant, the Republican, the great presidents for Reconstruction, is part of the reason today that most blacks are Democrats and not Republicans.
Wow.
Because of the betrayal. Now, there were several other factors that went on.
Sure.
But that was the start of that disaffection with the blacks from black people from the Republican Party.
And again, he did not have a second term.
No, he got knocked up as well. There's another little tidbit about the 1876. The Democratic Convention was held in St. Louis, Missouri. there was a certain lieutenant colonel named George Armstrong Custer who had kind of this aspiration to be the Democratic nominee, who decided to get attention by splitting his forces and rushing into the middle of the Sioux Nation at Little Bighorn, Montana, which was fairly close. And he actually had planned that he could win that battle, had reporters on hand, and still ride down to make the St. Louis Convention.
My goodness.
Right, which
yes,
didn't exactly work out like the
no,
way he planned.
Not at all.
Okay, so next time was the election of 1888. Came in, and you had Grover Cleveland against Benjamin Harrison. Harrison won, but only had one term as well. That wasn't all that monumental, what happened after that. And then everything was calm for 112 years until we ended up with Bush versus Gore. And again, Al Gore won the popular vote. And getting down to the hanging chads.
Yes, yes.
Now, one thing we can be reassured of, there won't be hanging chads in Florida today because they changed the voting machines.
There won't be hanging chads.
Right.
But there could be Supreme Court involvement.
There could
a
be.
Supreme Court that could be evenly divided 4-4. What happens if it goes there?
What happens is if we had the exact same situation as the year 2000.
Yes.
The Florida court in 2000, the Florida Supreme Court said, look, read the intent. If you can tell the intent of the voter, credit the intent of the voter, which is why you got into hanging chads and, you know, is it hanging by this much? But basically, if you could look at the vote and say, okay, this guy intended to vote for this, you had to count it. That was what the Supreme Court stopped, the United States Supreme Court stopped, that extra counting going on. What would have happened is probably Al Gore would have won. Now, that went to the U.S. Supreme Court. They stopped that. If you would have that today, where you have an evenly divided Supreme Court and no ninth justice, the decision of the lower court stands, which means the voting count, the vote counting would have continued, and arguably, Al Gore would have been president.
Isn't that something?
Yeah.
Now, as far as the Electoral College is concerned, is the Electoral College, you talk about the compromise, for goodness sakes,
right,
regarding, is this a problem waiting to happen again?
Absolutely. Let me just clarify something. And my son today said, oh, we're going to vote. Why are all these other guys' names under the main candidates' names? You don't vote for the President of the United States. You're not voting for Hillary Clinton or Donald Trump. You're voting for a slate of electors,
yes,
who are pledged to go and vote for the candidate. Now, what the original intent of that was to take away an overabundance of democracy in the United States. See, a lot of the electors in the Electoral College, the electors were chosen by state legislatures,
yes,
originally.
Yes.
Now, as time's gone on, we have direct voting of our electors by popular vote, and so that's why they become a slate with pledging. But there are instances in history where they haven't followed their pledge, the faithless electors. And so you could technically have something like, let's say somebody has a total nervous breakdown and they're a candidate, the electors could maybe not vote for him.
Or finally, talk about a November surprise.
A November surprise.
What about the idea of a candidate who simply refuses to concede?
Okay, constitutionally that doesn't matter.
Yes.
The president becomes the president. If they, it's become a custom and a great custom of American democracy, where you stand up and say, this is the president now, we have to support the president. And great politicians have done that. And by the way, smart politicians have done it and have resurrected political careers because of a good concession speech.
Mm-hmm.
You give a good concession speech, you might come back another day to fight. And that's what's been the motivation.
And again, if you don't give the concession speech and you refuse to accept, you better have a legal course of action or you're just going to be standing out in the street corner yelling at the stars.
There is none. And by the way, Americans hate sore losers. Every Super Bowl, the losing quarterback better get to the press conference and say, I got to hand it to my opponent. That's just American.
We've got about a minute left here, and we just talked about how divisive this election is. A presidential historian says most divisive since 1860.
Right.
Does it feel unusually divisive right now in this country?
There is a feeling of that, but I'm not sure. The players are divided. The talkers are divided.
Mm-hmm.
We're going to see just how divided the American people really are. And let me just give you one example. If you look at the culture wars and the issue of the culture wars, take any of them, same-sex marriage, the country's not divided on that anymore. There are players in the political arena who still are and still argue there should not be this or there should not be contraception or there should not be abortion rights. But the people have spoken on those issues, and I don't think they're quite as divided as the political junkies like us.
So a political Cold War, but not necessarily out there in the hinterlands. Good information. Good to have you here.
My pleasure, as always. Thank you.
Wednesday on Arizona Horizon, we will get a full recap and analysis of tonight's local and national election results, and we'll hear about the Phoenix Chorale's performance of a noted Duke Ellington concert. That's tomorrow on Arizona Horizon. Reminder now, the PBS NewsHour coverage of the election begins in just a couple of minutes or so, and we will have local results starting at 8 o'clock on 8.3, that's channel 88 on your Cox channel. That's it for now. I'm Ted Simons. Thanks for joining us. You have a great evening.
Arizona Horizon is made possible by contributions from the Friends of Arizona PBS, members of your PBS station. Thank you.